Please turn off all cell phones and electronic devices, or at least silence them, and rise for a moment of silence in the Pledge of Allegiance. Okay, we have one speaker to, I'm sorry, roll call.
Bunnison?
Here.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yep.
Anagnostakis?
Present.
Benton?
Here.
Berkman?
Here.
Benelli?
Here.
Cheney?
Here.
Dillard?
Here.
DeSalvo?
Present.
Ekis? Fagion?
Here.
Hines?
Here.
Chemnitz?
Here.
Kulisek?
Here.
O'Donnell?
Here.
Paduk?
Here.
Riskevich?
Here.
Sullivan?
Here.
Vero?
Here.
Gresham?
Here.
20 ayes, one absent.
Okay, we've got one speaker at the beginning of the agenda, Supervisor Robert Fromage, on the Heritage Trail parking lot.
Chairman, County Legislators, thank you for the opportunity to speak to you. I'm here to talk about the SECRA with respect to the Heritage Trail parking lot in Chester / Blooming Grove. I was once approached with dedicating the location in Blooming Grove for the Heritage Trail access by someone in the government. And my objection to having that done is that we have no Heritage Trail in Blooming Grove. We had four county legislative representatives on this committee, in the county legislature. And we have none, and we right now have very little hope of having them. So if I'm going to be asked to support a parking lot in Blooming Grove for Heritage Trail, I'm going to request that consideration be given somehow to the fact that we should also have a spur that goes into the Heritage Trail and connects it to the relating community. If anybody ever wants to talk about that with me, I'm in the office every day.
Thank you, Supervisor. Okay, Majority Leader Bunnison.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move to vote collectively on agenda item numbers 10 through 13, 33 and 34, 36 through 39, 41 and 42, 45 through 47.
Okay, if there's no objections, that'll be done. Oh, you want to repeat it?
Sure. Yeah, I was trying to go slow, I'm sorry. 10 through 13, 33 and 34, 36 through 39, 41 and 42, 45 through 47.
Are there any referrals, consents, or withdrawals?
Yes.
Yes, Legislator Bureau.
I request that item number 2 on the agenda, resolution of the Orange County Legislature giving notice of intent to assume lead agency status under the State Environmental Quality Review Act, SECRA, with request to the installation of sidewalks and curbing, off-street parking, and drainage along County Road number 13 in the hamlet of Sugarloaf, making a preliminary determination that this project be classified as an unlisted action, be withdrawn and referred back to the Physical Services Committee for 1 month. It's not because I don't believe in it. I think it's a great project, and I think we may be able to get some additional funding in the future.
Okay, if there are no objections, that'll be done as well. Any other referrals? Legislator Benton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At this time, I'd like to request that item number 5 on the agenda, the bond resolution authorizing the acquisition of furniture, fixtures, and equipment, and information technology improvements at and for the Orange County Government Center, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $8,250,000, appropriating said amount therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $8,250,000 of bonds of the county to finance said appropriation be withdrawn.
Okay. Okay, if there's no objections, that'll be done as well. Okay, I guess we're ready. We don't need to do this here. We did it already pretty much. Right, that's done. Okay. Agenda item number one.
Legislators Turnbull, Benelli, Vero. Resolution of the Orange County Legislature giving notice of intent to assume lead agency status under State Environmental Quality Review Act, SEQRA, with respect to the Heritage Trail parking lot in the town of Chester, Blooming Grove, making a preliminary determination that this project be classified as an unlisted action.
Second.
Discussion. County exec, I don't know if we want him to speak to this. Matt, let me see what you wanted to ask first.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. Please remove my name as a sponsor on this, although I'll be supporting it today. And I was just listening to the supervisor's remarks, and we've had discussions about heritage trails in that area of Blooming Grove. Certainly, heritage trails or trails in general are really good things, promote exercise, economic engines. And we're all supportive of it, and I just would request that the county executive be aware that there are other areas of the county that would like some attention on this matter of putting in these trails.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, I agree and can empathize with Supervisor Fromage for wanting to see more development in the town of Blooming Grove when it comes to recreation. This particular thing does address the residents and of Blooming Grove and Chester that utilize that trail. It provides for a safe environment to be able to park their cars off the road. I think it's a good thing, but that doesn't preclude us from investigating and taking in further the idea that Supervisor Fromage has had. And I know both Legislator Turnbull and myself have met with him about this, as well as some of the residents in the area, and and as well as Matt, who seems to be fully committed. In fact, I even talked to Commissioner Rose before his retirement about looking into something like this. So that's something that we can pursue as we move into the future. But this is definitely an enhancement for the Heritage Trail, and I will be supporting it. Thank you.
I agree with that. I mean, the Heritage Trail doesn't come to Montgomery either, but you know, it doesn't preclude consideration for other parts of the county in the future, assuming we get money or grants or help from the IDA or whatever. So, County Exec, you want to say a couple words about this?
Mr. Chairman, members of the legislature and the public, this is a no-brainer. We own the property. This property that we're talking about putting a parking lot on is the former Campo Guardia property, right across from the entrance. This would do nothing but facilitate not only the people of Blooming Grove, but anybody in our county or people coming to visit the trail. The biggest problem we have with the Heritage Trail today is access to parking. Go to Monroe, Ms. Chemnitz and Mr. Amo. It's packed. The commuters have overtaken that spot. If you come to Chester, where John Vero and I live, it's packed with people on the weekends. We own the trail, guys. Right next to the Heritage Trail, where we want to put this parking lot, is a 180-acre piece of property that the Orange County Land Trust bought a year or so called. I think it's called the Van Burg. I apologize, I'm mispronouncing it. The Orange County Land Trust, Jim DeLawn, 100% in favor of this. So not only will the people of Blooming Grove or our residents or people that come to visit this Heritage Trail be able to get right onto the Heritage Trail if they want to, they can walk right across and access this beautiful 180-acre preserve. It's the right thing to do. I'm going to hopefully be coming to you in the next few years if I'm here long enough. I'm definitely in Harriman as we now extend the Heritage Trail down to Harriman and also towards Middletown and Walk Hill. We should establish access points and parking areas so people can utilize. It's a gem. I live right on the Heritage Trail in Chester. I'm fine where I am. I can walk right outside my back door. But I see the volume of people using it. It's a great thing. This is a no-brainer. I have no idea why anybody would be against this. And I hope you support it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Yes.
Mr. Chairman, can I ask
you a question?
Not really. County executive wasn't on the list, and I've been told before.
I can recognize a county exec anytime.
You can't.
To address an issue on the agenda.
You can't recognize
Thank
me
you.
To respond.
No, we're not going to have a crossfire about you. You said your piece. Thank you. Roll call.
Honison?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis?
Yes.
Benton? Berkman?
Yes.
Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo?
Ekis? Is Ekis here? No?
He's going to be a little bit late.
Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Ryskevich? Sullivan? Vero?
Yes.
Brescher? 20 ayes.
Okay, two is withdrawn, correct? Number three.
Legislators Turnbull and Benelli, resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Department of Public Works to submit an application to the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation pursuant to section 99-H of a general municipal law and section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, Minority Leader Turnbull, Jeff and Katie.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This particular resolution amazed me because it was just mentioned, it seemed like yesterday. You know, I was at an event and I ran into Larry Rosini and we talked about it, and you know, I was thinking to myself, yeah, I'll make a phone call, I'm sure others will make a phone call, but this is Orange County, we'll move slowly. There's no way this is getting on the agenda in the next session. Well, here it is, we're voting on it, it's a good thing. It's a grant money, it's not going to cost the taxpayers of Orange County any money as far as I know, and dang, it's a win-win-win.
Jeff, and then Katie. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to echo the responses and the comments made by and the sentiments by Legislator Turnbull. All too often government works very, very slowly, but in this particular case, we were able to expedite this. This is a deadline situation that they can get this grant in. It has to be in by March 24th. And I really want to thank our Commissioner of DPW, Chris Bybrock, for acting so quickly on this. So I applaud them, and this is not going to be any taxpayers' money. In fact, it's money to be received to offset the cost that the Beaver Dam residents will have to incur. So I applaud the efforts of Commissioner Bybrock.
Okay, and add Legislator Hines to the resolution. Any other discussion? Okay, roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Diller? Visavo? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Ryskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Brescher? 20 ayes.
Okay, number four.
Legislators Kulisek, Turnbull, Paduk. Resolution authorizing the county executive to accept the proposed traffic signal easement in the town of Walk Hill.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonacic?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Ryskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Brescher? 20 ayes.
Ekis is also
yes. Thank you, Mr. Ekis.
Ekis is in the house.
21.
Okay, number five withdrawn. Number six.
Legislators O'Donnell and DeSalvo. Bond resolution dated March 2nd, 2017. Bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the acquisition of furniture, fixtures, and equipment, and information technology improvements at and for the Orange County Government Center, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $7 million. Appropriating said amount, therefore, and authorizing the issuance of 7 million bonds of the county to finance said appropriation.
Second.
Any discussion? Yes, Legislator Anagnostakis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I may be the lone voice here opposing this, but I will do just that. I will oppose it. I oppose it at committee. And I've got a couple of reasons for opposing this. First of all, I wasn't happy with the presentation that we got at the committees. I wasn't happy when a $9 million presentation came before us and all of a sudden it just magically became an $8.25 million presentation. And I wasn't happy when I looked at the paperwork and I unfortunately uncovered what I thought was double billing. It was confirmed to be. I uncovered what supposedly a 15% contingency was no such thing, it was much higher. And I just feel like we pay department heads and we pay personnel to do a good job. And for the most part, we get that in Orange County. But when we don't get that, it's my duty to speak up and say, hey, I'm not happy with what I got. I'm not happy with the work that's being brought before me. You know, yes, some of us sometimes are able to uncover things, but geez, you've got whole departments working on this. Why isn't someone uncovering it before it gets to us? So that's one potential reason that I'm not happy and won't vote for this. The dollar amount was lowered to $7 million. That's what we have before us, a $7 million proposal to buy new furniture and fixtures and equipment and computer information technology for the new government center. But I have a philosophical problem with that. Why is it that we need new desks for everybody? We're going to have 423 people moving into that government center. Why does everybody need to have new desks? Why does everyone need to have new chairs? Why do we need to have new tables? Why does every bookcase have to be replaced? Why do all the file cabinets have to be new? How about all those storage units? They all have to be new. I don't understand it. If it was my business, I wouldn't be doing that. And so I wouldn't do that if it was my own money. And I certainly won't do that with the taxpayers' money. So I'll be voting against it.
Okay. Yes, Legislator, Minority Leader Turnbull.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I had a lot of questions about this when it came before us at 9 and subsequently 8.25 million. I did some research and it seemed to me like the range on FF&E, municipal buildings in the Northeast is $8 to $12 a square foot. That's what I came up with. This put it more like it's 17. I did some math and it seemed to me like the right number was 6.5 million. One of the things I'm concerned about is the fact that it started at 9 and we're down to 7. There's just something about that that rubs me wrong. I mean, how do they initially come up with these numbers? Are they doing the work? I don't mind a contingency factor. I understand that you have to have some space in there for a number that, you know, may, as time goes on, when it's time to buy these products, it may go up, but sometimes it just seems to me like the number is way, way overinflated, and the problem with that is it's just a formula for abuse that, you know, if they came in at 9 and they bought everything for 8, they would claim success, and come in for, 7 and buy everything for 6.5. That's certainly a much bigger success. So, although I agree with much of what Mr. Anagostakis is saying, I'm going to support this today, but just reluctantly. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Yes. Legislator Hines.
Yeah, thank you. I agree with everything Mr. Anagostakis said. I disagreed with this in committee and voted no. And I'll be voting no today. I built a new house some 19 years ago, and I moved the furniture from my other house into my new house, and then I phased it in. I suggested we phase in new furniture as necessary. I realized some of it has to be done. The DA's area was wiped out. I spoke to the DA about that, but he was in the basement when the floods came. And I also agree that the presentation was severely lacking in committee, and as such, I'm a no on this. Thank you.
Yes, Myrna.
I too had a question about why can't we move with the desks and some of the furniture that we have? What's wrong with that? And there was an explanation that buying new literally was cheaper than creating and taking back the older stuff, which might not fit in some instances and might break in other instances. When I saw the number 9 million, I absolutely was horrendously upset about that. I figured out it should be the way I would look at things. If you're buying one chair for $80 and 100 chairs, you shouldn't pay the same price for each one of the chairs. You get an aggregate and the price goes lower. So although I was on the wall about voting yes or no for this or against this after we heard about it in caucus, I will be voting against it right now.
Legislator Amo.
Yeah. You know, I'm not on either of the committees, and I watched the development of 9 million down to 8.25 and down to 7, and I hear people saying, we can do it for 5, we can do it for 6. It just seems really sloppy to me. I don't know. It seems to me I trust Jim Burpo an awful lot. If he had $9 million and he could do it for 5, he's the guy that would do it for 5. I don't
know why we're trying to second-guess that, and so I'm not sure it's done well either.
I know there were questions that Jim was very sick for a couple of weeks. He couldn't make the Ways and Means, and I wasn't too happy with the presentation there either. Jim, can you just come up and give us some of the highlights of the furniture? And, you know, we don't want to belabor it too much, but I think, you know, time is of the essence on this. And going from $9 million to $7 million, I know you're going to have to cut some things. So maybe just get a synopsis. I know you explained to me about the furniture needs to be fire retardant and the ADA accessible, and there's some other things that we have to do, and hit on the computers too.
Okay, sure. Anything that we put out there or we put in a building for the public to use, whether it's your chambers, seating, any of that has to be ADA compliant. Most of the furniture we have is a minimum of 15 to 20 years old plus. Even in legislative offices, you have a furniture company coming constantly to replace your drawers, fix your stuff. That stuff is probably a good 10 to 15 years old, if not older. Now, this building was designed with space allocations and for maximum productivity, ergonomics, workflow, everything. So when you start bringing in furniture that's 15, 20, 30 years old, you've just thrown that all out now. So an office that may have been designed to hold two or three staff members, by the time they lug their stuff in, the old army desks, the old things that are falling apart, a lot of it, I'll be honest with you. Now you've just either displaced a worker, you've cut that office flow down. We've just really stopped government now, because now you have people that we have to find another spot for, we have to find more room for their stuff. So that's a big, big problem. When we did the merger between General Services and IT, I saw it firsthand. When we moved from 15 Matthews, we moved our furniture as much as we could over to the IT building. And I had a lot of the older filing cabinets and stuff that we've had for years. And when we lined them up and we put them there, I had there was a vendor that came in that wanted to show me, I think he was selling laptops or something. He was in a wheelchair. He couldn't get through the one aisle, and he goes, Commissioner Verko, I think you have an ADA problem here. And I said, I don't think so. I said, this building's pretty new, it's, you know. And he's like, well, no, there's not enough room for me to get by. So I called RISC. RISC came over. This is about a year and a half ago, a couple of years ago. And they pulled out their tape measure. And sure enough, the filing cabinets that I had, because they were old and how they extended out, had caused that. So I had to remove them. I had to put them in a different area. So if we start doing this, I mean, we want to repurpose whatever we can. And we've got enough departments that have even older stuff that repurposing it when everything's said and done to these other departments, it would be like a holiday gift for them. But going into this new government center, with the way it's designed and everything, we'd be penny-wise, pound-foolish if you don't let us get the right stuff in there, because you're only gonna pay for it later on, and I'm not kidding you. I mean, we're gonna negotiate pricing all the way to the day they're delivering the stuff through the door. That's what we do. But we need to get something in place, and to break it up, you know, then you're losing out on volume discounts for the whole price. You want to do this all, you have a time period to do it. Computer systems, I'll touch on that. The average computer system in the county is 8 to 10 years old. The newer ones are 6. You know, we're trying to do our infrastructure. We're trying to move it into more of a VDI for data security. I don't want to go too much into data security. I'd be happy to talk, you know, privately about that. You saw what happened at Stewart recently. We need those systems here. We need to upgrade those systems. And what better way we were going to do it across the board in the next few years than have it delivered right in with the new building, have the vendor deliver, set up, config it all with our people there to save a ton of money on that and be ready to go with it and be up and running. We've really looked at it. I'm sorry I wasn't at the last meeting. I wish I was. I was sick. I'm still a little under the weather, so I'm not in my A game right now. You guys are lucky. I'm still medicated a little bit. But, you know, I'd say I would really give it a hard look. The college, for instance, on a building 100,000 square feet, spent like close to $3.6 million. And most of that was labs and classrooms. We're fitting offices. So the numbers are, you know, we're right there. We're right there.
Thanks, Commissioner. I do have to say that this week, Jean, myself, Antoinette, and met with Chris Vibrock and the reps from Alianza, and I think our hands, and Cork, no, Alianza, we met with. Okay, Corcraft, we realize we pretty much have to deal with Corcraft on most of the furnishings. you know, we're going to get ourselves in trouble because of the differential and what the state mandates. But I think you did a pretty good job reviewing that. You know, what was presented at committee wasn't the best, but I think it was explained to us. And Gene and Antoinette had concerns about our office space because it certainly wasn't grandiose. And, you know, worried about a copy machine being down the hall and everything. So I think that was addressed by Commissioner Bybrock with them. There were concerns with the legislative chambers that we were cutting back to cheesy chairs and vinyl and just what we didn't spec to begin with. And we did have compromises with all legislators on the assembly hall. The Democrats, I know, wanted the seats staggered, and that's still in place. But we were told that the seats weren't going to be stationary, which there was a mistake by somebody in the DPW, so that was corrected. So, you know, I think we really need to move ahead. I just encourage us to vote for the $7 million. I think the bids could come in a fair amount under that, hopefully, but that remains to be seen. But we, you know, I wouldn't stall it another month, but we can't because it takes, there's quite a bit of lead time in ordering some of this furniture. So, yes, Legislator Benelli, then Legislator Perdue.
Thank you very much. You know, when we sit here and we decide on the various different projects and we talk into the millions, obviously we're all very concerned and we want to make sure that we're getting the maximum value for our money. I think that one important component that was kind of a selling feature for me, I understand that, you know, we're moving into a new building, we have to do all of this. I don't want anybody to walk out of here with the impression that whatever we're currently utilizing for the departments that are going into that building, as Commissioner Murpo said, the things that the furniture we're utilizing now will be repurposed. There's a lot of departments that have very, very old furniture, and they're making do with things, as Mr. Burbo had said, that are inadequate. And I'm looking back to one of our individuals that is a department head for community development, and you're smiling because I know how old your furniture is. And so the things that are a little bit newer, it was explained that they will be divvied up into various different categories. One that is purely not usable whatsoever, and other particular pieces of furniture and equipment that in fact can be repurposed and sent to other departments. So it's not just the departments in the government center that we're doing furniture for. We're doing it for practically the entire county and every department because we are in the buildings. And the Seward building obviously is very old, and so is their furniture. So hopefully you'll get something new, Mr. Mayfield.
Okay, Legislator Perdue.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I am a member of Fiscal Services, and there were a lot of questions asked there myself. This is pretty strange to me. Originally, it was $5 million for FF&E. They've added some other things. They came in at the 8.9, and then it went to 8.25. It's down to 7. I agree that Mr. Burpo will do the best job he can. However, they said that they didn't do the research on the items, but in my recall is that Clark Patterson and Lee knows what the building was. Why wasn't Clark Patterson and Lee involved in telling us what we needed for the designs that they did? That confuses me a little bit. And just so everybody knows, Corecraft means that we're paying inmates to make our furniture, and at that rate. So I have a little problem with it too. I think we could maybe save a little more of the furniture that we have that we could reuse, and I'm going to have a hard time supporting this as well.
Senator Cheney.
Thank you. Just to put some perspective on the numbers, yes, originally it was shown to us to be a $9 million project. Through more detailed and reliable quotes that our administration sought to receive, they were able to bring it down to $8.25 million. So it was through their work and efforts that brought about that reduction. And relative to the new furniture, if you look at the design, it's an open space plan, and that requires furniture with partitions. And as Mr. Burpo explained, with that configuration, it's difficult, if not impossible, to use existing furniture unless you have the kind that fits those types of configurations. Thank you.
And also in that original $5 million number, IT and security were not included, I don't believe.
Right. I believe that's correct.
Is that true, Jim? Thank you. Okay, any other legislators? Okay, roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
No.
Anagnestakis?
No.
Benton?
Yes.
Berkman?
Yes.
Benelli?
Yes.
Cheney?
Yes.
Dillard?
Yes.
DeSalvo?
Yes.
Ickes?
No.
Hemnitz?
No.
Horsack?
Yes.
O'Donnell?
Yes.
Paduk?
No.
Riskevich?
Yes.
Sullivan?
No.
Vero?
Yes.
Gresham?
Yes.
15 ayes, 6 noes.
Seven.
Legislators Benton and Anagnestakis, resolution approving the release of the county's interest in and to a certain detailed parcel to the previous owner record pursuant to Section 5, Paragraph B1 of Local Law Number 2 of 2010.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis?
Yes.
Benton?
Yes.
Berkman?
Yes.
Benelli?
Yes.
Cheney?
Yes.
Dillard?
Yes.
DeSalvo?
Yes.
Ickes?
Yes.
Fagion?
Yes.
Hines?
Yes.
Kemnitz?
Yes.
Kulisek?
Yes.
O'Donnell?
Yes.
Paduk?
Yes.
Riskevich?
Yes.
Sullivan?
Yes.
Vero?
Yes.
Gresham?
Yes.
15 ayes, 6 noes.
Okay, number 8.
Legislators Benton and Kulisek, resolution authorizing the privatization conveyance of certain county-owned lands acquired by reason of a failure to redeem said lands from a tax sale to Orange County pursuant to Section 10184 of the Real Property Tax Law and Orange County amended Local Law Number 2 of 2010.
Second.
Discussion. Yes, Alex.
Did I say 20? I apologize. 21.
Okay. Where were we? Now I just lost my train of thought here. Number 8.
Sorry.
That's all right. No problem. Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis?
Yes.
Benton?
Yes.
Berkman?
Yes.
Benelli?
Yes.
Cheney?
Yes.
Dillard?
Yes.
DeSalvo?
Yes.
Ickes?
Yes.
Fagion?
Yes.
Hines?
Yes.
Kemnitz?
Yes.
Kulisek?
Yes.
O'Donnell?
Yes.
Paduk?
Yes.
Riskevich?
Yes.
Sullivan?
Yes.
Vero?
Yes.
Gresham?
Yes.
15 ayes, 6 noes.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis?
Yes.
Benton?
Yes.
Berkman?
Yes.
Benelli?
Yes.
Cheney?
Yes.
Dillard?
Yes.
DeSalvo?
Yes.
Ickes?
Yes.
Fagion?
Yes.
Hines?
Yes.
Kemnitz?
Yes.
Kulisek?
Yes.
O'Donnell?
Yes.
Paduk?
Yes.
Riskevich?
Yes.
Sullivan?
Yes.
Vero?
Yes.
Gresham?
Yes.
21 ayes.
And number 14.
Legislators Turnbull, Kulisek, Benton, and Dillard, bond resolution dated March 2nd, 2017, bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the removal of contaminated soil at various county-owned locations, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $100,000, appropriating said amount therefore and authorizing the issuance of $100,000 bonds of the county to finance said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis?
Yes.
Benton?
Yes.
Berkman?
Yes.
Benelli?
Yes.
Cheney?
Yes.
Dillard?
Yes.
DeSalvo?
Yes.
Ickes?
Yes.
Fagion?
Yes.
Hines?
Yes.
Kemnitz?
Yes.
Kulisek?
Yes.
O'Donnell?
Yes.
Paduk?
Yes.
Riskevich?
Yes.
Sullivan?
Yes.
Vero?
Yes.
Gresham?
Yes.
21 ayes.
And number 15.
Legislators Turnbull, Kulisek, Benton, and Dillard, bond resolution dated March 2nd, 2017, bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the improvement of intersections, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $100,000, appropriating said amount therefore and authorizing the issuance of $100,000 bonds of the county to finance said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, Ruskovich, Sullivan, Vero, Breschah, 21 ayes.
Okay, number 16.
Legislators Ruskovich, Benelli, Benton, Berkman. Bond resolution dated March 2nd, 2017, bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the construction of drainage improvements, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $200,000, appropriating said amount therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $200,000 bonds of the county to finance said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion, roll call.
Lunasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSavo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Ruskovich? Sullivan? Vero? Breschah? 21 ayes.
Number 17.
Legislators Vero, Ruskovich, Benton, Hines. Resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Public Works Airport to accept grant funds from the New York State Department of Transportation pursuant to Section 99-H of General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion, yes.
Want to be added?
Roll call.
Lunasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis?
No.
Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSavo?
No.
Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Ruskovich? Sullivan? Vero? Breschah? 19 ayes, two noes.
Okay, number 18.
Legislators Lunasek, DeSavo, Ruskovich, Turnbull. Resolution of the Orange County Legislature assuming lead agency status under State Environmental Quality Review Act, SEQRA, with respect to the Orange County Public Safety Communications Project, Cronimer Tower, in the town of Newburgh, classifying the action as unlisted and determining that the action will not have any significant adverse environmental impacts.
Second.
Discussion, roll call.
Lunasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman?
No.
Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSavo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Ruskovich? Sullivan? Vero? Breschah?
And number 19.
20 ayes, one no. Legislators Ickes, Lunasek, Benton, O'Donnell. Amending bond resolution dated March 2nd, 2017, further amending the bond resolution adopted August 1st, 2013, and amended October 2nd, 2014, and further amended December 3rd, 2015, in relation to financing the cost of the acquisition, installation, and construction of a new emergency communication system for the Department of Emergency Services and Communications at the estimated total cost of $28,591,345.
Second.
Discussion, legislator Fagion wants to be added. Okay, Paduk wants to be added. Vero wants to be added. Okay. Roseanne, I?
I hear you.
Sorry, sorry. Kevin, do you want to be on this? All right, Kevin's on it too. Okay, roll call.
Lunasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSavo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Ruskovich? Sullivan? Vero? Breschah? 21 ayes.
Number 20.
Legislators Fagion, Lunasek, Benton, DeSavo. Resolution authorizing the Orange County Department of Emergency Services, Police Services, to transfer funds from a general fund to restore alive at 25 revenue pursuant to Section 4.10 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion, yes, Jim Kulisek? Okay, added. Roll call.
Lunasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSavo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Ruskovich? Sullivan? Vero? Breschah? 21 ayes.
21.
Legislators DeSavo and Lunasek. Resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Emergency Services to accept grant funds from the New York State Division of Homeland Security and Emergency Services pursuant to Section 99-H of the General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion, legislators Fagion and Chemnitz want to be added. Okay, roll call.
Lunasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Amo.
Yes.
Anagnestakis.
Yes.
Benton.
Yes.
Berkman.
Yes.
Benelli.
Yes.
Cheney.
Yes.
Dillard.
Yes.
DeSalvo.
Yes.
Egan.
Yes.
Caputa.
Yes.
Sholdoff.
Yes.
Ordinance 2021-22.
Legislators Bonacic and DeSalvo, resolution authorizing the county executive to donate five mobile radios to the city of Hartford, Connecticut pursuant to section 215 of the county law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacic.
Yes.
Turnbull.
Yes.
Amo.
Yes.
Anagnestakis.
Yes.
Benton.
Yes.
Berkman.
Yes.
Benelli.
Yes.
Cheney.
Yes.
Dillard.
Yes.
DeSalvo.
Yes.
Egan.
Yes.
Caputa.
Yes.
Sholdoff.
Yes.
Ordinance 2021-22.
Legislators Bonacic and DeSalvo, resolution authorizing the county executive to donate five mobile radios to the city of Hartford, Connecticut pursuant to section 215 of the county law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacic.
Yes.
Turnbull.
Yes.
Amo.
Yes.
Anagnestakis.
Yes.
Benton.
Yes.
Berkman.
Yes.
Benelli.
Yes.
Cheney.
Yes.
Dillard.
Yes.
DeSalvo.
Yes.
Egan.
Yes.
Caputa.
Yes.
Sholdoff.
Yes.
Ordinance 2021-22.
Legislators Bonacic and DeSalvo, resolution authorizing the county executive to donate five mobile radios to the city of Hartford, Connecticut pursuant to section 215 of the county law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacic.
Yes.
Turnbull.
Yes.
Amo.
Yes.
Anagnestakis.
Yes.
Benton.
Yes.
Berkman.
Yes.
Benelli.
Yes.
Cheney.
Yes.
Dillard.
Yes.
DeSalvo.
Yes.
Egan.
Yes.
Caputa.
Yes.
Sholdoff.
Yes.
Ordinance 2021-22.
Legislators Bonacic and DeSalvo, resolution authorizing the county executive to donate five mobile radios to the city of Hartford, Connecticut pursuant to section 215 of the county law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacic.
Yes.
Turnbull.
Yes.
Amo.
Yes.
Anagnestakis.
Yes.
Benton.
Yes.
Berkman.
Yes.
Benelli.
Yes.
Cheney.
Yes.
Dillard.
Yes.
DeSalvo.
Yes.
Egan.
Yes.
Caputa.
Yes.
Sholdoff.
Yes.
Ordinance 2021-22.
Legislators Bonacic and DeSalvo, resolution authorizing the county executive to donate five mobile radios to the city of Hartford, Connecticut pursuant to section 215 of the county law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacic.
Yes.
Turnbull.
Yes.
Amo.
Yes.
Anagnestakis.
Yes.
Benton.
Yes.
Berkman.
Yes.
Benelli.
Yes.
Cheney.
Yes.
Dillard.
Yes.
DeSalvo.
Yes.
Egan.
Yes.
Caputa.
Yes.
Sholdoff.
Yes.
Ordinance 2021-22.
Legislators Bonacic and DeSalvo, resolution authorizing the county executive to donate five mobile radios to the city of Hartford, Connecticut pursuant to section 215 of the county law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacic.
Yes.
Turnbull.
Yes.
Amo.
Yes.
Anagnestakis.
Yes.
Benton.
Yes.
Berkman.
Yes.
Benelli.
Yes.
Cheney.
Yes.
Dillard.
Yes.
DeSalvo.
Yes.
Egan.
Yes.
Caputa.
Yes.
Sholdoff.
Yes.
Ordinance 2021-22.
Legislators Bonacic and DeSalvo, resolution authorizing the county executive to donate five mobile radios to the city of Hartford, Connecticut pursuant to section 215 of the county law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacic.
Yes.
Turnbull.
Yes.
Amo.
Yes.
Anagnestakis.
Yes.
Benton.
Yes.
Berkman.
Yes.
Benelli.
Yes.
Cheney.
Yes.
Dillard.
Yes.
DeSalvo.
Yes.
Egan.
Yes.
Caputa.
Yes.
Sholdoff.
Yes.
Ordinance 2021-22.
Legislators Bonacic and DeSalvo, resolution authorizing the county executive to donate five mobile radios to the city of Hartford, Connecticut pursuant to section 215 of the county law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacic.
Yes.
Turnbull.
Yes.
Amo.
Yes.
Anagnestakis.
Yes.
Benton.
Yes.
Berkman.
Yes.
Benelli.
Yes.
Cheney.
Yes.
Dillard.
Yes.
DeSalvo.
Yes.
Egan.
Yes.
Caputa.
Yes.
Sholdoff.
Yes.
Ordinance 2021-22.
Legislators Bonacic and DeSalvo, resolution authorizing the county executive to donate five mobile radios to the city of Hartford, Connecticut pursuant to section 215 of the county law.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonacic.
Yes.
Turnbull.
Yes.
Amo.
And there's tons of kids in Newburgh and other places, in Highland Falls yesterday, 80 kids getting the backpack program that we are implementing. Nobody else is there. And I'm saying that this is a code issue that if a city manager or a city mayor or a town supervisor, there's a couple of them in the audience, says, look, we're overwhelmed with code violations, our bill inspectors are overwhelmed, we'd like to have the county health department come in and help us, that's for the sanitary code. In 6 months, I think a couple of us talked about, let's do a progress report. If it doesn't work, we throw it out. Joe DiStefano called me this morning, we hashed through it, he said, fine, I can live with it. George Green called me after Legislator Ekus called him last week, very well, doing your homework. I think, Jeff, you might have called the mayor. That's doing your homework as a legislator. The municipalities, we've walked them through the process. So we had a meeting with all the supervisors and mayors that came, which was overwhelming majority of them. And that's what this is for. It's not a taking. I have better stuff to do. You have better stuff to do. But we also have a moral obligation, I believe, to help out when we can. And that's literally what this is. And if we don't like it, we can scrap it. Give me 2 months, give me 6 months, give me a year. But I think it's something that is something good that we can do, and I can show each one of you why it's important if you wanted to go out in the street with me and do it. So that's what it's about, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Discussion? Yes, Legislator Cheney, and then Curley, and then Minority Leader Turnbull.
This change to the Orange County Sanitary Code, as the county executive said, will give the county health department enforcement rights over property maintenance issues in local municipalities. Local municipalities already have property maintenance laws on the books and have the staffing capabilities to enforce these laws. This legislation will unnecessarily create a second level of government to enforce the same law. The fiscal impact of passing this law on the county is unknown. At this point in time, we have no way of knowing how many complaints will reach the county due to a lack of action or unwillingness on the part of local officials to enforce the law in their municipality once the county law is in place. We all know that the county health department does not have the staff resources to implement this program should municipalities decide to let the county do the enforcement. As the county assumes the burden and cost of this responsibility, will the municipalities in turn reduce their staffing and cost to the taxpayer? By the county taking this over, the municipalities and their taxpayers who continue to do their own job of enforcing these laws will be paying for enforcement in municipalities who do not choose to do so. To the county executive's point, if there is a need for this law to assist any of the county's local towns, villages, or cities who, for whatever reason, lack sufficient resources to enforce their local law, then we as a county should seek another means whereby the county can assist them temporarily for this or any other reason. For these reasons, and because I believe in smaller, more efficient government, I will be voting against this local law.
Thank you, Mr. Cheney. Legislator Dillard.
Thank you very much. I am 100% behind this local law based on the city of Newburgh and the conditions that some of my constituents live in. We have sanitary conditions, running sewage, going through our apartments. But the thing that's most important, we have children, and our children are being affected based on the fact that in some units they do not even have hot water. Now, our city of Newburgh building inspector's office, it is overwhelmed. And I'm certain that this would work in the city of Newburgh. Therefore, I endorse this and will vote for this 100%. Thank you.
Thank you. Minority Leader Turnbull and then Legislator Berkman.
Thank you. First, I'd like to say that, yes, I'm a veteran, and I feel, in retrospect, that I fought for the right of anybody to protest legally. And it's unfortunate that the county executive saw it proper to criticize that. I'm a no vote on this, and the reason is that, you know, there's a lot of people who, you know, you know, I agree that there's a lot of people out there who may be violating various codes, but I'd rather see something that's going to help these people comply to the codes. When reading some of the things included in this code, I also had a problem. Some of the words used dilapidated. I don't even know what that means. One person's building that's dilapidated is another person's building that, you know, is homing or something like that. There's a lot of formula for abuse in this particular law. I'd like to see it adjusted in a direction that serves all the people, you know, of Orange County.
What's there, Berkman?
You know, there's different roles that we play. One is to use our judgment over resolutions, and the people vote for us to use whatever abilities we have to make those decisions on their behalf. And there's another role that we play where we represent the interests of our community, including its leadership in your own district. So let me respond first to the macro, the larger point. I think there's validity to some of the people that have questions about this. However, I welcome the county executive saying at least if this passes, it should be a trial run and then further analysis. It's my understanding that when I spoke to Mayor DiStefano, I spoke to Rich Gurdon, Corporation Counsel, I spoke to Jacob Tewill, Commissioner, I spoke to the city manager in Newburgh. I think there's a consensus among the people I spoke to that they would welcome an opt-out provision for any municipality that wants to. I understand that there may be a legal challenge with equal protection, I've been told, but this implementation of this resolution doesn't occur until October, I believe, so we'll have some time perhaps to have a second resolution to address some of the perceived deficiencies, at least for us to analyze those. Another one is a major concern to me is if there's a building or an area which is in need of health remediation that's identified, I think that there should be a withdrawal from county action if the property in question is a municipality. And this becomes more important for the three cities because when there's a default on property, typically that's where these problems occur, at least frequently. When there's a default on payment of taxes, the property then goes to the city rather than to the county. So we need some clarification and adaptation to suit the needs of the three cities. The reason why I'm going to vote for it is because of what Curly Dillard said, actually, and that is there's a need for improved health. And I think that when I spoke to the city manager specifically, he embrace the idea of having county inspectors to come in and do that additional work that they are overwhelmed. So it's in that spirit that I'm willing to give it an experiment to try. Middletown was okay with it pending those additions, so I'm looking forward to working to make this better.
Yeah, Legislator Fagione and then Legislator Ruskevich.
Thank you, Chairman. One of the more unique legislators here on this body. I represent the city of Port Jervis in its entirety. I also represent the town of Deer Park and a small portion of the town of Mount Hope. So for me, this perspective is rather interesting because on one side I have a great supervisor in Gary Spears, who's the town of Deer Park supervisor, who says that his building inspector and his department is doing very well in the town of Deer Park to handle their matters. But also I have the city of Port Jervis in which the city of Port Jervis has a building inspector and an assistant who operate within the city confines. And on February 23rd, the city of Port Jervis held a public forum an open forum discussing blight in the city and what can be done about abandoned houses. I went to the meeting, and one of the things I found interesting, and for fellow legislators, I don't mean to bore you, in the year 2016, there were over 1,400 violations issued in the city of Port Jervis on buildings. And that's commercial buildings as well as residential buildings. And when the county executive stood up here and spoke, I appreciated his comments. He mentioned two things. Number one, is this being an issue of public safety and health, especially for children, and I applaud him for mentioning that. And also, number two, he mentioned it as a tool to help municipalities. Well, in the case of the town of Deer Park, this tool is grateful but not necessary. But for the city of Port Jervis, it's a tool that is necessary. I always like when I can look over and see Mr. Berkman and say I can reach across the aisle and work with him. I'm going to stand with Mr. Berkman. I'm going to vote for this today as well for the city of Port Jervis. And also, I'll be willing to come back and look at it in a few months' time. And if it's not working properly for everyone within the county, I think we have enough smart people up here on this board who make the right decision and move forward. Thank you for your time, Chairman.
Thank you. Paul.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, I'd just like to say I understand the intent of this law. I think the intent of it is good. I realize there are problems in certain areas of the county. However, I don't think that a countywide approach is the right solution. I think there's probably other ways that we can address these issues. I did speak to the three supervisors in my district, and none of them thought that this would be any great help to them. I believe the only legislator in committee to vote no on this, and I will be voting no again today. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? Legislator Sullivan, I'm sorry.
Okay, thank you. Just quickly, I'd like to say that I absolutely agree to what Legislator Dillard said, and it really pulled at my heartstrings. I think it is much needed, though, not only in the cities, but all over Orange County. When we consider the term slumlords, you don't have to think just about the city. We have them everywhere. And they are in my neck of the woods, in the town of Walk Hill area as well as Crawford area. And I can't imagine them not existing anywhere else. And I can also not imagine allowing this occur. Many times in those municipalities, the people who are in charge of going out and inspecting do not have the teeth that they need to actually make any change. I sat through these presentations, and we had a lot of discussion about it on the Health and Mental Health Committee. And there were a lot of questions answered, and I felt very confident in the answers that were given. And I'd also say that I would never support anything that would weaken this law, because I think that it's necessary to have it stated exactly the way it is, and I appreciate all of the work that went into it, and I will be supporting this today as well.
Okay, roll call. Legislator Duke.
Just one question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We've heard concerns today, though, about maybe reviewing this. This law doesn't say that right now, that we would have an opportunity to review it. Maybe we get a lot of complaints, maybe we say it's a great thing and we can renew it. But I know there were concerns about it, so I was gonna ask that if under the effective date, if we added for a period of 1 year, at which time it would be reviewed so that those concerns are addressed as well. So we'll have a year of it.
It's a local law. We can review it or amend it at any time. Like, it could be 2 months hence, it could be 6 months hence, or much longer. So we always have that opportunity to bite at the apple again. Yes, Legislator Anagnostakis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will be supporting this. As Ms. Sullivan said, it did go through a couple of committees, one of which was my committee, the Health and Mental Health Committee, which I think we vetted it very well over a many month time period, and had a lot of questions asked and answered. Just so everybody understands, it didn't originate in the legislature. This originated with the health board. The health board, which, because I'm the chairman of the Health and Mental Health Committee, sit on the health board. The health board is comprised of various professionals in the public sector, in the healthcare field sector, health administration, doctors, various people of those, Dr. Avila, the head of our health department. That's where it originated. That's where a lot of research was done. That's where this was helped to be put together. That's where it passed after many months and got to the legislature, where the legislature then started its process to work on it. So my view is, if it was good enough for the health professionals in Orange County, it is something that we should definitely give a shot at. Thank you very much.
So are you saying we should give you a little more credit because you're on that board too? Okay, roll call. Yes. Absolutely. Curly's on it too. Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
No.
Emu?
Yes.
Anagnestakis?
Yes.
Benton? Berkman?
Yes.
Benelli? Cheney?
No.
Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich?
No.
Sullivan? Bureau?
No.
Gresham?
Yes.
17 ayes, 4 noes.
Okay, number 25.
Legislators Amo, O'Donnell. Resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Mental Health to accept and appropriate funds from the Center for Regional Healthcare Innovation, LLC, pursuant to Section 99-H of the General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, Jeff wants to be added, and Mike Padu. And roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Emo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Padu? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresham? 21 ayes.
Yeah. Yeah, Roseanne wants to be added. No problem. 26.
Legislators Sullivan and Ekis. Resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Mental Health to accept 11 transmitter kits, as well as accept and appropriate funds from the New York State Department of Criminal Justice Services pursuant to Section 99-H of the General Municipal Law and Section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion?
Would I be added?
Yes, Mary Cheney added. Roll call.
Bonacek?
Yes.
Turnbull? Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagion? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Padu? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresham? 21 ayes.
Okay, number 27.
Legislators Fagion, DeSalvo, Benton, and Benelli. Bond resolution dated March 2nd, 2017. Bond resolution of the County of Orange, New York, authorizing the preservation of historic records in the county clerk's office, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof is $125,000, appropriating said amount therefore, and authorizing the issuance of $125,000 bonds of the county to finance said appropriation.
Second.
Discussion? Yes, Legislator Berkman.
Thank you. I'm sure we share an interest in protecting our historic documents and our legacy, and we're blessed to have some important documents and deeds on animal skins and all the rest. It's actually quite exciting. When the clerk's office first approached the committee that I served, I thought that it needed review. Evidently, the majority of the committee agreed with me. We sent it back for a second try. At the second try, it was much better, so I appreciate the extra effort that was put into it. I'm still not really sure about adding up the $125,000, but like most things, when we make estimates, we can watch it carefully to make sure that the money's spent wisely. First, we were thinking whether Alexander Hamilton had original signatures. I expect we don't, but an improvement in the second go-round was that the county historian was there to assist as well, which is just totally logical if you think about it, right? If we're talking about historic documents, even if it's under the custodial care of the clerk's office, it only makes sense that our Orange County historian would be involved. And then lastly, I managed to, because of my personal interest in these things, I called up the New York Historical Society Museum and Library. I spoke to a very interesting guy, Alan Balicki, a chief conservator of the library, and I passed this on to everyone on the committee. And if we watch the expenses, this could be a very exciting thing for us to do, and I hope that we put them on display in our new building.
Yes, Minority Leader Turnbull.
I want to stop, thank Legislator Bergman for his work on this resolution. I also want to point out, I just want to make it clear that I just want to say a few things, and I think it's important because I think it is part of what I'm supposed to do. Mr. Bergman was removed from rules for asking questions about, I think, about this particular resolution. You know, all the legislators have areas of expertise, and when we are having discussions in those areas, different legislators tend to be more involved, and I think the other legislators on the committee appreciate that, because none of us know a lot about a lot of different things, but most of us know something or enough to comment on particular resolutions. Now, I also want to say that I was removed from Ways and Means Committee, and the reason that was given was because I was being too partisan. Well, I've never been partisan on Ways and Means. On Ways and Means, I'm all business. I'm watching every single penny, every single tax dollar. So, yeah, there's been times, usually the first January meeting of the year, the reorganization, when I was accused of being partisan. But basically what I was asking is for the Democrats to share power. I specifically asked for a chairmanship on the ad hoc committee. It's been said that...
Can we stick to the issue at hand, Matt? This is not, you're getting off tangent here.
I know that, Steve, but I just want to clear
Well, let's
the
bring
air.
It back.
Okay, well.
Please. I'm saying a couple things that just aren't true, but go ahead.
Well, we can talk about that.
So,
And finally, I just want to say one other thing that I have to say this in public, because if you say it in private, it's kind of like gets around and it's kind of a rumor. But the speech that I gave was my words. It was not the words of the county chairman. And finally, I just want to say that when I submit a name, when the chairman asked me for a name to be on a committee, I choose the person that I think is most qualified.
Point of order.
And when he rejects that name, I want the reason why he rejected the name of the person I submitted. That person is more qualified than anybody on the legislature to be on that committee.
We are on this preservation of historic documents.
And it's wrong.
You're out of line.
It's wrong.
You're out of order. You're out of
Orange County.
Stop.
And I'm going to speak out.
Stop.
I'm going to speak
go ahead and speak out after the meeting.
If I could just everybody, deep breath. I totally respect, Matt, what you're saying, and your time to say it, though, is not appropriate. Each one of us, at some point in our tenure here, have gone on off task on a resolution, and we've been called out, and we respect the process, and we come back to the topic. This, I know you're trying to say it publicly. This is not the forum right now to do it. We're here to do the people's business, and I just want to make that clear. I'm not trying to be disrespectful, but anytime any of us talk over the chairman,
we're called back to the press,
Matt,
right?
Matt, you're not respecting the process. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Please. Okay. Okay, the resolution? Yes, about the resolution, please.
I also want to thank Legislator Bergman for his expertise on this resolution and his hard work. And I want to say, Jeff, that I really do appreciate your background, and I appreciate having you around when it comes down to discussing historical documents. And on that note, I'd like to note that I have 21 years of experience in public education, and I would just like to ask the chair why you keep refusing my appointments to the SAGE committee, which has to do with public education. Can you at least just answer that?
You want to know?
Yes.
I'll tell you.
So you're not the
yeah.
You're not the bar that
I'd like to hear your answer.
Okay, enough.
I think that I deserve an answer.
We're on 27. Myrna, you're next.
And you've been asked over and over.
You're out of line.
I have never explained to me.
If you keep going on, I will have you escorted out of the room.
Why you didn't answer a question.
I will have you. I cannot. We will adjourn the meeting. Point of information. It's a discussion off topic. Point of information. This has nothing to do with the topic we're on.
It's not really off topic. It has to do with expertise of legislators.
Point of information. Point of information.
Yes.
County attorney, if legislators want to speak on topics that are not related to what the question is, that is not appropriate here, correct? That would be after the session is over, before adjournment, correct?
After we do the motions that are before the legislature, then the chairman can recognize legislators to speak.
Thank you.
I'd be glad to save my comments to that point.
Okay, and I will answer your comments at
no,
that
but
time.
I, thank you.
Yes, Legislator Kemnitz.
Number 27.
This is on the resolution specifically. I was at.
Last speaker said that too.
I was at both of the meetings that we had, and a lot of material came to the second meeting that wasn't at the first. But at the first meeting, we did learn that the county did put in a grant application to SHPO for preservation of documents that are required by law, and there are hundreds and looks like thousands of them that were required. And they had to preserve those. They did not get the grant. And on the recommendation from SHPO, I believe, they did approach a woman who specifically was working as well in museums in Manhattan, because I had asked a question to have you gone to the museums to find out, like the Museum of Natural History, whom they use. Subsequently, at the second meeting, we received almost a book of information, including a whole dossier on what this particular woman has done, what she intends to do, what the pricing is, as well as we saw examples of the kind of materials that are required by law to be preserved. It's not just the sheepskins. That was the bulk of a price that when we looked at it. But when you saw the aggregate amount of what must be done, you have to take that into consideration too, because you're not following the law of preservation all the way back. We have families who have been here since the 1600s. So I just wanted to make it clear that we did get a lot of information. We did see a lot of things. I'm going to vote for it because of the language. If you look really closely, it says estimated maximum cost. So you've got the word estimated and you've got estimated maximum. So that's the top that it would be. But we did try for a grant. And when I say we, it's because we are a government, and in government, this is what has to be done. Thank you.
Yes, Legislator Bunnell.
I would just like to take the opportunity to clarify a few things. And Myrna, you're absolutely right. And I'm glad that you shed some additional light onto that. And those of you that can remember back to December, this was when this first came to the Rules Committee meeting. And there were a lot of questions, many of which were asked by Mr. Berkman, and they were actual great questions. And the presenters, the county clerk, could not be with us at that meeting. And the deputy clerk, along with one of the other clerks from the county clerk's office, did the best that they possibly could with the information they had. All of us on the Rules Committee in December rendered that this was not an adequate presentation to be able to explain why they wanted to do this capital project. When they came back to us in January at the Rules Committee meeting, we got this document, which was very, very extensive, talked a lot about the things that Myrna was referring to, and we were supplied the information and the answers to the questions that were made by Mr. Berkman, as well as other legislators on the Rules Committee. The reason that we're dealing with it here in March is because of circumstances beyond the clerk's department. They could not attend the Ways and Means Committee. They felt it was important enough to share this information with the legislators that sit on Ways and Means, and they asked that this be withdrawn from the agenda last month, so they had the opportunity to come to Ways and Means and follow the procedure, and that brings us to today. So that's to kind of shed some light and clarification on this, and there were a lot of people that were part of this, but this was the document that we finally got the information we needed to move forward. Thank you.
Yes, Legislator Ben.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd also like to point out that obviously in different calendar years with state departments and such, grant applications, there's certain priorities that are 1 year and certain priorities that are completed in 1 year, so they move on to the next round the next year. So the clerk's office is still going to be pursuing grants for future preservation of documents as well. So this is a really, some others have said, a non-ending process, but it's not the end of grant opportunities.
Okay, and I will say that I have an appreciation for history and historical preservation probably as much as anybody in the room. I've shown it as mayor of the village of Montgomery. We have one of the largest museums in the county of Orange. Our village was, the first village board meeting was 207 years ago this month. The village was incorporated 207 years ago last month.
You weren't the mayor back then.
I wasn't the mayor. They were both presidents back then, believe it or not. So, Legislator Berkman had some good questions at the committee. That is certainly not the reason that I made the change. You can construe it as you will, but I don't mind questions. I embrace questions, but when there's so many questions that don't lead to an answer, that's what I have a problem with. I'm not going to get off the subject any further, but I'm just going to tell you, as far as this committee and this line of questioning, there was no reason why any change was made because of that. So, roll call.
Bonnison?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Benagnostakis? Benton?
Yes.
Berkman?
Yes.
Benelli?
Yes.
Cheney? Dillard?
Yes.
DeSalvo?
Yes.
Ekus? Fagione? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero?
Yes.
Gresha? 21 ayes.
Okay, 28 is the local law that sat on the desk, received and filed. Number 28, local law, number 2.
Legislators DeSalvo, Fagione, Paduk, Benelli. Local law introductory number 2 of 2017. A local law to establish energy benchmarking requirements for certain municipal buildings in the County of Orange.
Second.
Discussion. Yes. Legislator Ekus.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I'd like to apologize for my lateness. Number 2, I'd like to say, like Mr. Berger, I'm not on my A-game today. Number 3, I'd like to thank you, Chairman, for allowing the Green Committee to continue on. For those of you who are not aware, this particular law is just one part of what we are undertaking as a county for the clean energy communities. There are a total of 10 tasks, of which we have to complete four, to qualify, and in qualifying, what that will do will allow us to apply for grants and have a greater capability of acquiring those grants. I just wanted to let you know that at this particular moment in time, having attended a meeting at the end of last week at Orange County Community College, that Orange County Community College is actually probably going to fulfill 3 out of those 4 requirements alone. So we're well on our way, and I certainly hope that this is unanimously passed, and I'm very excited, as I always am, on environmentally concerned issues.
Yes, Legislator Cheney.
Would you add me, please?
Yes, I will. Legislator Berkman.
I'd like to compliment Mr. Ekus for his leadership on energy issues, and please add my name as a sponsor.
Erlen.
My name as well.
Yes. Yes, Carlin. Erna.
All Dems.
All Republicans? All Dems?
Yeah.
Okay, everybody.
May we come in with benchmarking?
I can tell you what?
The word benchmarking means?
What the word benchmarking? You probably know. It's a rhetorical.
What kind of an issue?
Who else wants to explain that? Anybody?
It's defined in the resolution.
Okay. Somebody's on the ball. Lee.
Mr. Chairman, would you please add my name? And I'd also like to thank Mr. Cheney, who is the chairman of the Green Committee.
Thank you. Thanks to all. Okay, roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Emo?
Yes.
Nagustakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Kemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Ryskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresham? 21 ayes.
Okay, number 29.
Legislators Benelli, Hines, and DeSalvo, resolution of the Orange County Legislature to name the New York State Thruway Bridge that replaces the Tappan Zee Bridge to the Brown Page O'Grady Bridge.
Second. Yes, legislator. All Republicans? Discussion? Yes, Jim Kulisek wants to be added. Roll call? Legislator Turnbull?
Yes, certainly this is a worthy resolution. I did a little bit of research. There's other things out there promoting renaming the bridge, one Purple Heart, the other one Pete Seeger, Jerry Garcia. You know, I think that these type of resolutions, you know, when you kind of look into them, you know, you see there's all kinds of options. Being a veteran, I got to go with the Purple Heart.
Okay. Legislator O'Donnell?
Thank you, Chairman. This is a backup resolution to what we passed last month regarding the commutation of the sentence of that terrorist, Judith Clark. Okay, just my law enforcement background. Public recognition of our law enforcement heroes is an important fabric of our society. And I spoke about my brother-in-law getting killed in the line of duty last month, but this public recognition of law enforcement, I'll just give you another personal story. Just say, two of my five daughters live in Virginia, so I spend a lot of time driving south on I-95 to visit them. And a section of the road on I-95 is dedicated to Corporal Theodore Wolf of the Maryland State Police. So he was killed in the line of duty back in March 29, 1990. And I was fortunate to lead a team of investigators from the state police, helping the Maryland troopers. Captain Terry Sheridan led the Maryland State Police, and we were able to apprehend the two criminals that killed Corporal Wolf. He left behind a wife and three kids. But every time I visit my children, I'm reminded of the fine work of law enforcement in apprehending these killers of police officers. And President Trump, to his credit, recognized law enforcement twice during his address the other day. So certainly the Purple Heart, and there's many, many others, but we're running out of roads to honor all the police officers that have been killed in the line of duty. So I hope all my legislators here will join me in a unanimous recognition of the heroes from Rockland County and rename the Tappan Zee Bridge in their honor. Thank you.
Arnold, do you want to say something? You want to be added? Okay, not a problem. Okay, roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
No.
Emo?
Yes.
Nagustakis?
Yes.
Benton?
Yes.
Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard?
No.
DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion?
Yes.
Hines?
Yes.
Kemnitz?
Yes.
Kulisek?
Yes.
O'Donnell?
Yes.
Paduk?
Yes.
Ryskevich?
Yes.
Sullivan? Vero?
Yes.
Gresham? 19 ayes, 2 noes.
Okay, number 30.
Legislators DeSalvo and Hines, resolution of the Orange County Legislature amending resolution number 2 of 2017, which established the legislative calendar for 2017 pursuant to Article 2, C1F of the Legislative Manual.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Emo?
Yes.
Nagustakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagion? Hines? Kemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Ryskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresham? 21 ayes.
Okay, number 31.
Legislators DeSalvo and Kemnitz, resolution confirming the reappointment by the county executive to the Orange County Board of Ethics pursuant to Local Law 5 of 2015.
Second.
Question? Roll call. Oh, yes, Michael Amo added. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull? Amo?
Yes.
Nagustakis? Benton? Berkman, Benelli, Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ickes, Fagione, Hines, Chemnitz, Corsick, O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Bresch, 21 ayes.
Okay, number 32.
Legislators DeSalvo, Chemnitz, Benelli, resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County Department of Planning to accept and appropriate funds from the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation pursuant to section 99-H of a general municipal law and section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion. Did Mike Paduk add it and Chris Ickes add it? Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton, Berkman, Benelli, Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ickes, Fagione, Hines, Chemnitz, Corsick, O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Bresch, 21 ayes.
Okay, number 33 and 34.
Second.
Discussion?
Yes.
Jeff Berkman added to both of them?
Early, both of them?
Okay, Jim Corsick, both of them? Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagione? Hines? Chemnitz? Corsick? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Bresch? 21 ayes.
And number 35.
Legislators Anagnostakis and Benelli, resolution confirming the reappointments by the county executive to the Orange County Veterans Advisory Board Committee.
Second.
Discussion. Legislator Fagione. A roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagione? Hines? Chemnitz? Corsick? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Bresch? 21 ayes.
Okay, number 36. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I didn't get that one. 36 to 39.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagione? Hines? Chemnitz? Corsick? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Bresch? 21 ayes.
Okay, number 40.
Legislators Berkman, Ickes, resolution authorizing the county executive in conjunction with the Orange County historian to accept and appropriate grant funds from the Pomeroy Foundation pursuant to section 99-H of a general municipal law and section 4.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion. Legislator Fagione added. Roll call. You want to speak too? I'm sorry.
Very briefly, Chairman. Thank you. I'm very happy to be added to the list here, and I'd like to just make mention for the public record that the Pomeroy Foundation, this will be the second historical legends and lore marker that they're going to be putting up here in Orange County. I'd just like everyone to know the first one was put up in the town of Deer Park, not far from my childhood home. So very happy to see this happen. Thank you.
Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes? Fagione? Hines, Chemnitz, Corsick, O'Donnell, Paduk, Riskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Bresch, 21 ayes.
Okay, number 41. I don't know if we do both these. I think we do them separately. Yeah, I believe 41 and 42, which are separate. We can do them together? Okay, all right, let's do them together then. Okay, I didn't think we could. I know we did it at the beginning of the meeting, but I didn't think we could. So what's that? You want to be added?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Second.
Okay. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ickes?
No.
Fagione? Hines? Chemnitz? Corsick? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan?
No.
Vero? Bresch? 19 ayes, 2 noes.
Okay, number 43.
Legislators Cheney and Paduk, Resolution extending the period of time for the appointment of Christopher Vibrock to serve as acting commissioner of the Orange County Department of Parks, Recreation, and Conservation by the county executive pursuant to Section 3.09 of the Orange County Charter.
Discussion? Yes.
I'm just wondering, and I wasn't at the committee meeting, I apologize, but is this a temporary thing, or was there was there a date given as to when we would be able to hire?
County exec, what's that? I'm sorry. Yeah.
Yes, it's through July, and I believe Commissioner of Human Resources is here. They've canvassed, they've advertised, they have resumes, they have to go through them, so thank you.
We've got over 40 or 50, I think, last count. Okay, yes, Myrna?
I am definitely for this. I have to say that whenever I've asked for any kind of information, I've gotten it back within 24 hours, 48 hours tops. And certainly the extension, I think, is a wonderful idea, and I would like to make it.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Roll call.
Anderson?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnestakis?
Yes.
Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Fagione? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Riskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Brescia? 21 ayes.
Okay, number 44.
Legislators Fagione and Cheney. An act amending the appropriate Orange County employment schedules to create tourism director at the Orange County Division of Tourism pursuant to Section 2.02I of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Okay, I'm going to recognize the county exec to say a few words on this. This was going to be sent back to committee, but I think there's urgency to create the position and then subsequently over the next month or so work on an economic development plan for this position. So, County Exec.
Mr. Chairman, members of the legislature, just give you a little perspective of where we are today, where we were, you know, 4 years ago. We're bringing in about close to $500,000 more from the hotel motel tax. We have about seven hotels that are either under construction, recently opened, or, you know, going to be done within the next 6 months. As you know, last Thursday, we announced a new airline coming to Stewart Airport. They'll be coming here in June, bringing in about 7,000 foreign passengers a week. And if you come to Stewart Airport right now, there's more information on Sullivan County than Orange County. And that's just one example. I think we have a great opportunity. And I'm just talking about tourism first and our role in economic development. I'm going to make it as brief as possible. So what I'd like to see is these flights are going to start in June. We are also, I believe, we're very close to possibly announcing another, not only destination, but another airline coming into Stewart. So we're really at a catalyst that's been talked about for decades. Stewart International Airport has only been international with cargo and military for the last few decades. These are the first real international flights. So we have a great opportunity now. So what I'd like to see is we've married them at Coach USA. The passengers are going to be bused down in New York City. I like to marry them with visiting places in Orange County, not only stopping at Woodbury Commons on the way back, but maybe stopping and seeing some of the wineries, or maybe stopping and seeing West Point or the Washington headquarters or this, that, and the other thing. So what it requires from us is to take tourism to a new level. That the three, we bring in now $3.5 million a year from the hotel motel tax, mostly from people visiting this county. And I think it's a great opportunity. It will be able to, I highlight Stewart because it's in the news and it's out there and it's sexy and it's exciting. But we have a lot of other things we can do with it. And the other thing with what Chairman Brush is talking about, it's heading in the direction of economic development. There's a lot of pressure coming down from the state about having economic development held where you have public meetings, where people's financials, the people that are on boards, have their personal finances have to be public. So the days of doing business as it is today are a thing of the past. And it's coming down because of regulations. People on the boards need to be able to show their personal tax, their personal incomes. So that's why I think we're heading in that direction. In tourism heavy, because economic development is tourism, but we need to be prepared. This is an opportunity. Norwegian isn't a guaranteed thing. If they flop in 9 months, that might be the last opportunity we get. a Legionnaire just announced that they're going to do an extra flight. JetBlue called immediately to say that they want to announce connecting flights for people coming from Norwegian Airlines. And we announced last week that we're going to do Great Britain, Scotland, and Ireland. But I believe probably in the next few weeks we'll be announcing another international destination with them. So it's an exciting time. We budgeted this last year. We budgeted two more positions to grow this department. And I had some discussions with individual legislators. I don't care what the job title, if you guys want to make it a 25 or 23. We got to start, it's starting to build this department and bring it into the modern times. And I think we have a lot of exciting stuff. I think it's an easy discussion because most of that money is, or all that money is coming from the hotel motel tax. Steve Gross is here with me to talk about technicalities about the positions, or the position that we're talking about today, because we did budget two. But I think it's money well served, and I think you guys are seeing a return for the investment on tourism. So with that, Steve, you want to have Steve talk about the position first?
Does anybody want to hear more on the position? What's your pleasure?
You've heard
quite a bit in committee, but yes, Legislator O'Donnell.
I'd just like to hear about the economic development.
Absolutely. That's what I said. I mean, this is the prelude to an economic development office within tourism, because that's what it is. Tourism is economic development, and it's going to grow. You know, we had discussions on this. It's not just the county executive that has to or should do this. Signing up the Blue Angels 2 days ago. Signing up to Thunderbirds, meeting with different other businesses that are coming here. You know, I'm not saying I love doing it. It's great stuff, but it's something that a professional economic development office would be doing, and that's what we're going to be growing as the legislature and the county executive together as we start moving in that direction as this county grows. Our unemployment being so low, a big problem is with new businesses coming here hiring people. How are we going to do that? What type of office is going to do that? We've talked a little bit about the educational things that we're starting to do in the three cities, preparing Orange County residents to start working for different job opportunities. But there's a major shortage, I think, in effort on economic development that we need to seize upon, and we do that by building up an office of economic development and tourism. I think that, if that explains it, Jimmy. We can go more. I'll go as far as we want to go on it. We can. I'll come back next month with some plans on...
With a plan.
But I'd like to work with the legislature on it, on what your vision is. Maybe Jimmy, since he's had experience. I think Barry, you're the chair of the committee that handles it. So maybe, and obviously...
John Bureau is, John or Bureau. Paul is, but it's also could go to BNC, but it didn't.
And whoever Matt recommends, and obviously Mr. Ramo, but we need to start growing this county. And I think it's an easy discussion to now create this office that will take us to be able to meet some of these things, working in hand in hand with some of other economic development partners.
Okay. Discussion? Yes, Legislator Kulisek.
Will this remain a division, and will it remain under the county executive's purview?
That's up to look. The only office right now that's really a part of my office is budget. Everybody else is just a department head. Chris Bybrock, Public Works. Darcy Miller with DSS. So we could.
Well, the commissioner's not part of
that. I'm open either way. And Jimmy, I've been front and center with economic development, and I would love to have it still with me. But it's up to discussion. Whatever you guys want to do.
Creating another department would be a charter change. Huh?
So let's make it simple.
Legislator O'Donnell again.
I think we have an officer
in the House of Representatives. Got to use a mic, Jim.
That's one.
We don't have an extra mic or that?
We have an Office of Economic Development. Unfortunately, the only person that is in it is the county exec. Okay? And he's a little busy, so I'll be speaking further once anyone else has this say.
And Harry Ford is his position is with the, not only as Director of Operations, but he's also directing the Foreign Trade Zone. So we can start growing this department. Mr. Gross says it is a separate department within the county executive's office.
Correct.
But it really, the only person that's there now, as Jimmy said, is Mate Jim. It's a minor role of Harry Poore's, a major role of mine as executive. But definitely something that's worthy of some growth and independence.
Okay. Further discussion? Legislator Ickes and Ruskovich.
Thank you. I'm all happy to talk about economic development, but right now I'm talking about a tourism director, and that's what we are focusing on. Since the day I got into this office, was elected into this office, I have fought to dismantle the tourism department. I was outvoted many times, and I have to honestly say that more times than being outvoted, I was actually convinced that it was the right thing to do, to a point that it was just mentioned by our county exec that we passed a resolution and money was put into this budget for two additional positions. Let's get this clear. If we hire a tourism director, there's no other position. I sat through the meeting, PNC meeting, and listened to what they had to say. I think a number of things that came up were the need for doing IT, somebody who knows how to tweak, new forms of social media. I do not believe that somebody we're going to hire in as a tourism director in charge of this entire department are the type of people that know the new methods of social media and are aware of it. I believe it's people that we bring in, the young folks that we bring in the trenches, that will know it better and best. I'd mentioned that I have been opposed to the Department of Tourism. But believe it or not, that opposition brought me very close to Susan Habermail, who is the coordinator. And until today, until just moments ago, again, the mention by our county exec of a lack of advertising at Stewart Airport, I had heard no complaints about the Department of Tourism and what they were accomplishing. You know, I have to honestly say that we did vote at one point, and I'm not quite sure where we're having a disagreement, but we voted one time, which I disagreed with, about moving the Department of Tourism under the county executive's purview. We specifically did that. I realized that Susan Habermail, as a coordinator, is in the CSEA and not directly responsive to the county exec. But again, until today, I hadn't heard any problems relative to her functions, her position, or what she's doing. As a matter of fact, I've heard compliments about it. So I am not convinced at all at this point that we need to form another administrative position when we specifically put monies in there for two additional positions. And to me, the people in the trenches are the people that produce the best. Up to this point, again, I have not been convinced. It is my hope that we vote this down, because not only was this proposed, but it was proposed such that, again, the coordinator's position remains. And no description was given to me as to the difference between a director's position and a coordinator's position. So it seems like a duplication. The department is under the county exec's purview. He can do as he wants, but I do not believe that we need to throw money at this particular position at all. Thank you.
Legislator Ruskovich, and Agnestakis, then Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As Chairman of Education Economic Development, I'd just like to say that I am supportive of both tourism and economic development. I think there's a lot of very exciting things happening with tourism here in Orange County, and I think it is important that we do need to put some more resources there. And of course, tourism is a very important driver of economic development. And I know in past month's committee, we did have some discussion about, director of tourism compared to director of economic development. I think that's something we're going to need to take another, take a very good look at and have a good discussion on. I think Mr. O'Donnell is going to comment more on that. I know the county executive speaking a few minutes ago, you mentioned having a director of economic development within tourism. I'm not sure that's quite the way we want to go. I think we need to have a director of economic development overseeing all economic development in the county, including tourism. But, you know, economic development, there's a lot more than just tourism. So I think we need to take a serious look at that. So, thank you.
Legislator, next thoughts?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. While I'm always leery about adding new positions, I'll continue to listen to the debate on this. But I was certainly heartened when I heard the executive say that he didn't care if it was a grade 23 or 25. So I will make a motion and hope someone seconds it that we make this position a grade 23 and change the two parts where it says grade 25 into a grade 23 and hope someone seconds that.
Second.
Okay, discussion on that motion? Yes, Legislator Stavel.
I'll defer to Commissioner of Mr. Gross. I'd like to find out if that would be a smart move, if it's something that we could do. If that's okay with the chair.
Yes.
Thank you. So, you know, when we looked at this position, we looked at the entire organization, and one of the things we take into account are other positions, like title, like grade. And when we looked, we created the Director of Human Rights recently as a grade 25. We have many of our county departments that are directors, the Director of the Office for the Aging, grade 25, the Director of the Risk Management Department, grade 25, Probation Director, 25, Community Development, 25, and your own Clerk of the Legislature is a 25. Our review was, after reviewing the facts and the rest of the organization, 25 would be the appropriate range. It would be a management range of $66,447 to $108,913. That was one of the considerations that came into the two positions being proposed and the one position going forward. I think the mindset was, let's get a director in place, let them evaluate the department, make their own decisions as to what's necessary for additional staff. So we wanted to take the conservative approach and come forward with one position and review it at a later date if the necessity for another one arised.
Point of information, can I find out what a 23 and a 24 are, the ranges for those two?
Hold
up
for you right now, sir.
Thank you. And just, you know, we've been all over the place here. You know, Paul mentioned no economic development, or we're not sure if it should be separate or not. This is something we're going to grow and talk about. But one conversation that Legislator Ika said, first of all, this is not about Susan Everett. It's not about a staff member. They're understaffed for the job that they are going to be tasked and are tasked to do. And when you come to Stewart, the reason why you haven't heard complaints is because people are probably not utilizing us enough. When you land at Stewart Airport, as opposed to any other airport in the country, it says, welcome to Stewart, Newburgh, good luck to wherever you're going. That's it. Not welcome to Miami. We have this, that, and the other thing. Please visit this, please visit that. Booths all over the place, information things. There's nothing like that at Woodbury Commons, where people come up here by the thousands. We need to start harnessing them. We need to take the office to the next level. Economic development is another big catalyst that Mr. O'Donnell and I are very passionate about, that we think we should be growing as well as a department in the county. And Mr. Gross and I are comfortable talking about that, but I'm not sure whatever everybody's comfort zone is. If everybody's comfortable is growing tourism the way it is, fine. But we want to take it to the next level. We want to take economic development to the next level. Our track record over the last 3 years has proven that, and I think we can do nothing else but grow on it. But we have an opportunity now. Like I said, if this stuff flops, things can change overnight. And okay. It's a big impact.
We can always go up with the grade as well if we do start out at a 23 or 24. Commissioner Gross, did Donna just give you the figures?
Got it, sure. Grade 23 starts at 54.
Wait, 000. Listen, please. Say a little louder.
Sure. Grade 23, $54,536 to $89,390. Grade 24, $60,198 to $98,670.
I would think the grade 24 is a little more apropos for what we're looking for this position, if we're going to go down. You know, that's my opinion. Legislator Sullivan was next, and then, I'm sorry, you weren't done yet, I'm sorry.
Can I amend? I'd like to, based on the information that we just received and the input from the chairman, I would like to amend, if the seconder of my motion would agree, my motion from changing it from a 25 to a 23 to changing it from a 25 to a 24.
Marna, you're okay with that? Marna?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right, Legislator Sullivan, then we have Hines, then we have Dillard, then we have Benelli. Sorry, Katie. I got to go in the order I saw.
And this is only on the motion, right? On this motion?
On the amendment, yes.
Oh, on the amendment, sorry.
Yes.
I think the top grade, is it 25 or 27? What is it? 29? Okay. 25 is pretty close, you know, and I remember having the discussion, being a member of the PNC committee, I remember having that discussion that we had so many administrators who were at the top of their grade, and they were kind of stuck there, and we were trying to make it worth their while, right? Because they weren't getting raises, and they hadn't gotten raises, and it really wasn't fair, and it was such a gruesome discussion that we had to go through. How are we going to give these people raises when they're at the top of their grades? And what I noticed was that most of the people on that list were new hires who were hired at these high grade levels, and it was putting us in an awful position. And that's why I'd be totally against, I'm for lowering it down to anything. I'm against this anyway, but if you're gonna try to lower it, then you know what, Godspeed, that's great. I would support that because of the fact that we've gotta stop hiring people at the top of the grade level. That's such a waste of money. When people, taxpayers, realize or find out what we're doing here, they'll realize how we're wasting money. And we've got to be a little more creative when it comes down to this. I know that it's Mr. Gross's job to decide what grade the job description fits in, but I would also like to throw out there that he must be under a lot of pressure to make the position fit into a nice, perfect, grade for the right person. So I'd like to thank Mr. Anagnostakos for making the motion to lower it.
I don't think that was his thoughts. Okay, Legislator Dillard.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. This is a far too important conversations that we're having pertaining to this legislation. What I would suggest that we take this back and iron it out and leave your egos at the door, work with the county exec and the legislature and get something suitable.
Second. Motion to send back to committee. Okay, discussion on that motion.
Yeah.
Yes, Legislator Ickes.
Wasn't there a motion already that didn't we have to?
But this supersedes that right now. This supersedes that.
Okay.
I just call the question on call on send it back to committee.
Yeah, is there no discussion on that? I know what to do, but I had to ask if there was a discussion first. Thank you for your help. Okay. All right. You roll call on the you want to talk about the motion to go back to committee? Okay, go ahead. Now you jump ahead of Kevin.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to jump ahead of Mr. Hines.
Because you're talking about this issue.
I'm talking about this issue, and I believe Mr. Hines was going to talk about this issue.
No.
The discussion we're having right now as far as...
is on the amendment to send it back to committee.
Exactly.
Was that what Kevin wanted to speak to? Okay, then let Kevin go before you. Okay. Go ahead.
Listening to this dialogue, we need to send it back to committee. When I asked at caucus last evening, because I did not have all of the information, I also had the opportunity to speak to the county executive about all of this. So I was relatively comfortable. And quite frankly, I thought it was kind of out there on my own and I didn't really have a handle, but I was going to do my due diligence and speak to people that I needed to in order to prepare for today. Well, I come here, I'm listening to this whole dialogue, and no one has a clear handle on this. The dialogue that has just occurred should not be occurring at a legislative meeting. This is the dialogue that needs to be occurred at the statutory committee meetings.
And just as I said earlier about we didn't like and we didn't get the questions we wanted in regard to the preservation of records, and we sent it back to the department and said, do your due diligence, bring back all the information, and we got it, so that we were all at a comfortable point where we could vote here. This dialogue, while I appreciate it very much, and quite frankly, I'm learning a little bit more about it, shouldn't be occurring here. This is not the place for that. So I wholeheartedly agree to send it back to committee.
Okay, Kevin, I didn't mean to jump over you, but we did go to the amendment question, and Katie had her hand up.
Early, Katie said it's fine.
Okay, ditto? Okay. Okay, Michael, was it on that, or just we're going to roll call on sending it back to committee?
Ditto.
Roll call on sending it back to committee.
Onasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis?
Yes.
Benton?
Yes.
Berkman?
Yes.
Benelli?
Yes.
Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo?
No.
Ekis? Bagione?
No.
Hines? Hemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell?
No.
Paduk? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Bureau?
Yes.
Gresham? 18 ayes, 3 noes.
Okay, we're on to number 45. Number 47, I stand corrected. Collective. Okay, so we don't read them. I'm sorry. Okay, Legislator Paduk, I'm sorry. We get a second? No?
Second.
Okay. Yes, it will be so. It'll be duly noted. I'm sorry. Okay, roll call.
Onasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yep.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Bagione, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, abstaining on number 45, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Bureau, Gresham. 21 ayes except on number 45, 20 ayes, 1 abstention.
Okay, numbers 48 through 50.
Second.
Oh, they're all separate? Why do I have it? Jesus, excuse me. 48 then, right? 48? Okay.
Legislators Bagione, Paduk, and Bonasek, an act amending the appropriate Orange County employment schedules to reallocate Deputy Commissioner of Emergency Services, Division of Police Liaison Services to the Orange County Department of Emergency Services pursuant to Section 2.02I of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton, Berkman, Benelli, Cheney, Dillard, DeSalvo, Ekis, Bagione, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Bureau, Gresham. 21 ayes.
Okay, number 49.
Legislators Bagione, Cheney, and DeSalvo, an act amending the appropriate Orange County employment schedules to reallocate, reclassify, abolish, and create various positions at the Orange County Sheriff's Office pursuant to Section 2.02I of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call.
Bonasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yes.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Bagione, Hines, Chemnitz, Kulisek, O'Donnell, Paduk, Ruskevich, Sullivan, Vero, Gresham. 21 ayes.
Okay, number 50.
Legislators Paduk, Benton, and Dillard. An act amending the appropriate Orange County employment schedules to reclassify Executive Secretary and Administrative Assistant to Executive Assistant at the Orange County Department of General Services pursuant to Section 2.02I of the Orange County Charter.
Second.
Roll call. Discussion. Roll call.
Onasek?
Yes.
Turnbull?
Yes.
Amo?
Yep.
Anagnostakis? Benton? Berkman? Benelli? Cheney? Dillard? DeSalvo? Ekis? Bagione? Hines? Chemnitz? Kulisek? O'Donnell? Paduk? Ruskevich? Sullivan? Vero? Gresham. 21 ayes, Mr. Chairman, and the desk is clear.
Okay, before we go to the public portion, and the county legislative attorney has something to say, I just want to say that there was some misinformation out in the public about our earlier meeting at 2 o'clock. That meeting was with respect to the lawsuit on the annexation of the 164 acres in the town of Monroe, and I'll defer to Chairwoman Katie Benelli to explain a little bit further, if you would, what that was about, so just so the public knows, it doesn't always get out there.
It has been the policy of the Rules Committee to, on a periodical basis, to get updates from legal counsel, as well as the liaison legal counsel that is representing the municipalities. As you probably all are aware, we have joined with local municipalities in regard to an appeal on the proposals for annexation in the Kiryas Joel town of Monroe area. The most recent information that we had received just came in. We felt that after advice of legal counsel, it was a little to wait to our Rules Committee meeting, which would be on March 22nd, was actually waiting too long. So knowing that the full legislature would be here, and of course full legislature is always invited to these particular meetings, we did call a special meeting at 2 o'clock. All legislators were invited. We started off the meeting with a status report from legal counsel that was open to the public, so anybody that was there got to hear where we are with that, and then to be able to answer some more definitive questions when it came to client attorney privilege. We went into executive session for a period of about maybe 25 minutes. So just to update you, that's exactly what had occurred today. No action was taken, no action was proposed to be taken.
Thank you, Legislator Benelli. County attorney, county legislative attorney.
Yes, thank you. Before we start the public participation and recognition of legislators, I just wanted to point out some provisions of our legislative manual, which has been adopted and is adopted each year by the legislature. So some of the portions that I'm going to recite to you talk about the decorum, order and decorum here, talking about the appointments of committees and the appointment of statutory committees. So I'm going to start off with order and decorum, which is number 6 under the rules of order and procedure for the Orange County Legislature. And this applies to legislators as well as to the public. So order and decorum at meetings. All members of the legislature, persons addressing the legislature, and all persons present at meetings shall address their remarks through the chair, and such remarks shall be confined on the issue and subject matter of legislation, which is the subject of debate. Any such remarks shall not be directed to the motives or character of members of or other persons, and if made, shall be out of order. All members and all other persons present shall refrain from disturbing the assembly or hampering the transaction of business by disorderly speech, movements, or other disruptive conduct. The chair is empowered to remove any non-member person from a meeting for such disruptive speech or conduct. So that has to do with order and decorum. Now, there have been issues that are being raised regarding the appointment of members of the legislature to statutory committees. And in our legislative manual, it provides under Article 2, Section 8, Subdivision D, Number 2, appoint statutory committees. The chairman must, comma, within 30 days of his election as chairman, appoint from among the membership of the legislature the chairman and members of each of the following statutory committees, which we have, I believe, 8 of them, and it names them as established by the Administrative Code, Section 2.15. Now, as for the appointment to standing and special committees, which I heard some discussion about that earlier, Section 2, Article 2, Section 9, D3, talks about the appointment of standing and special committees. Upon authorization by a majority of the legislature, in each instance, the chairman may appoint such standing and special committees as shall, in the opinion of the legislature, facilitate the conduct of its business and fulfillment of its functions. The chairman shall be ex officio a member of any standing or special committees appointed by him. So in other words, the chairman makes the appointments, but those have to be authorized by the majority of the legislature. So I point that out to the public, those three provisions of the legislative manual, and I point it out to members of the legislature as well as the public, just to give you a sense of what our legislative manual provides. And the legislature has the authority and does so every year in January during their organization meeting. They appoint the chairman, and they also approve this legislative manual. And years ago in the past, sometimes the legislative manual resolution will be referred back to committee so that any changes or any amendments that the legislature wishes to make could do so through the committee process. And so I encourage each and every legislator that if you find that some of the provisions in this legislative manual need to be revised, that we do so each year. That would be done in the Rules Committee. So I just bring that to everyone's attention. And I do wish that everyone considers that this is not to stifle First Amendment speech, but to provide order and decorum at these meetings. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll go. You'll have ample time to speak after the public portion, okay? First speaker on a non-agenda item is Mary Ann McDonough regarding the follow-up to the last month's meeting.
I spoke at the 2217 Orange County Legislative Meeting. My topic was Speak Truth to Power. The truth was the unprofessional, retaliatory, bullying, disrespectful, excluding behavior. The power was the Orange County Legislative Chair, Steve Brescia. Three other Orange County citizens also spoke about Chairman Brescia's unprofessional conduct. I ended my 2-2 presentation with the following. Let us hope by speaking truth to power, the 2017 legislative agenda will provide for democracy at its best and stop the bullying and reprisal we've already experienced. Very unfortunately, at that same meeting, right after our four Orange County citizens, including myself, spoke, we were once again subject to Chairman Brescia's egregious behavior. Brescia gave us another glaring example of that unacceptable behavior. Let me refresh your memory as to what happened. For those who did not witness this, please go back and review the video, which is on the Orange County website. The last speaker finishes, Brescia then states motion to adjourn. At that point, before the meeting is officially adjourned, Democratic Minority Leader Matt Turnbull raised his hand to be acknowledged by Chairman Brescia. On the video, I witnessed it myself, but it's on the video, Brescia states, "What do you want to say?" Turnbull begins to speak, but what he's saying is inaudible. Brescia then asks the second question, which is audible. Is this going to be another political speak like the last meeting, quote unquote? Turnbull's response is again inaudible, but while Turnbull is speaking, Brescia interrupts and restates, "I entertain a motion to adjourn." Some other legislator, who also must not believe in the First Amendment, says, "So moved." With that, Chairman Brescia walks off the dais. Turnbull was still speaking and could not be heard. It appears just because Chairman Brescia did not like what Matt Turnbull said at the last meeting, Turnbull was being denied his right to speak as an equal and as a colleague of this 21-member body. I am sensing an all too familiar and similar modus operandi between our national political arena and our local Orange County political arena. Mitch McConnell didn't like what Elizabeth Warren was saying when she attempted to read Coretta Scott King's letter. McConnell had no right to stop Warren from speaking the truth, and Chairman Brescia has no right to stop Matt Turnbull from speaking the truth. In both instances, not liking what is being said is insufficient to curtail free speech. Mitch McConnell owes Elizabeth Warren and the American people apology, and you, Chairman Brescia, owe Democratic Minority Leader Matt Turnbull all of your fellow legislators and the citizens of Orange County an apology. Obviously, Chairman Bresser, you weren't listening at the public comment period at the end of the 2217 legislative meeting when four Orange County citizens took umbrage with your unchairman-like behavior. Instead, you had to show all of us who were here on 22, and because of video, all of Orange County, how rude and disrespectful you can be to one of your colleagues. Chairman Bresser, you put into action what four citizens were politely asking you to stop doing. If you, Chairman Bresser, do not want to change and act more chairman-like while conducting business in this body, there will be consequences. I, for one, will continue to stand up and identify unacceptable behavior when I see it. I hope and pray your fellow legislators, whether they be Dems, Republicans, or Independence Party, will also stand up. When your fellow legislators ignore rude, disrespectful, and bullying behavior, they are complicit. Lastly, I'll leave out the last part because I know you're going to gong me, but at the end, all of us,
I
by not...
I want to hear all this. Please keep going.
Oh, thank you. Lastly, I hope and pray that all who are bullied, intimidated, disrespected, and not treated right, whether within this legislative body or anywhere in Orange County, that they will respond like Elizabeth Warren has stated. We will not be silenced. We will speak out. We will persist. All of us, by not demanding respect from those who are disrespectful, lose our own self-respect. And in effect, condone unacceptable behavior to continue and flourish. We cannot allow that to happen in this legislative body or anywhere in America. Thank you.
Thank you. Charles Davenport, regarding the Dover Plains Power Plant, CPV. He's from Wappingers.
Hi. First of all, I'd like to offer my profound appreciation and thanks for your actions in this body in December 3rd, 2015, when you passed a resolution 2040 condemning the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Thanks to your action and the similar actions from dozens of governmental bodies across this nation and the objections of millions of citizens across this nation, we are now not saddled with a trade agreement that would only benefit the corporate elite of this world. Your action was at the forefront of those who recognized that a trade agreement negotiated in secret with the input of international corporations, 500 or 600 of them, could only benefit those corporations and not the interests of American workers or American citizens. Thank you very much. I pray that you will continue to be vigilant in the protection of America and the people of Orange County from corporate predators and looters. New York State is currently under attack from corporate public enemy number one, which is the gas and oil industry. This industry is desperate to get rid of its product. Its product, gas and oil, are commodities whose value will soon be diminished as the world transitions to renewable sources of energy. Right now in New York State, over in Dutchess County, we are facing the Dover Plains gas power plant to be constructed in a couple of years. We have the Pilgrim Pipeline. We have oil barges in the Hudson River. There's a Spectra Atlantic Bridge pipeline in Westchester and Putnam. There is a methane gas storage facility proposed to be put under Seneca Lake in the grape growing region. And of course, we have the CPV power plant down the road. Now, a couple of years ago, fracking was deemed to be a risk to the health and safety of New Yorkers. And yet, the gas and oil industry now obligates us to risk our clean water, to risk our clean air through the use and transportation of their noxious fracked gas and Bakken oil feed crude oil. All that stands between us and devastation by this predatory and criminal gas and oil industry are bureaucrats in the state's Department of Environmental Conservation. So I'm urging you today to take action. Please pass a resolution asking our Governor Cuomo not to issue the number 41 water quality certificates necessary for these projects to continue. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Stephen Burke, one, the appeal of the suit against the Monroe Town Board, and number two, the North Monroe Committee.
The bell rings. I want to thank you again for extending the Heritage Trail into Harriman. And before the town of Woodbury Planning Board, that large village-sized project, the Harriman Station, includes extending the Heritage Trail right up to the station. So you'll be able to get on your bike in Goshen and take the train into the city. I'm glad you're looking at whether or not to join the appeal on the 164 acres, which, as if you read the recent article by a very good reporter, it's somewhere about 95 acres that are at risk there. I voted on it. I studied it for a year, and it seemed like a natural thing to do for a village that was growing, that needed housing, and this is a good way to give it to them, and I voted for it. And then besides that, the two adversarial sides went to court, New York State Supreme Court. And Judge Walsh did a 94-page decision on it. So the judiciary has spoken. The request for an injunction from the appellate division was met with denial. So we might have exhausted what we should be doing with the judiciary. And now you'd be sitting down in a committee looking at the town of North Monroe, and you have the people, elected officials that can handle this and know what they're doing. So I think it's a transition time. We're leaving behind adversarial litigation and moving forward with constructive conversation. So I want to support you in finding a new way to work with the village of KJ and meld them into Orange County so that everybody's needs are looked at and respected. And thank you very much.
Hey, Bennett Weiss from Newburgh regarding ICE.
Originally, I was planning to talk about ICE, and I was sort of fumbling for how to begin, but the county executive gave me a real good idea. We are moving in a very dangerous direction. The county executive tirade today is just proof of how dangerous a slope we're on. We're accepting fascism, fascism, fascism. I've been around a lot longer than the county executive, and I've sat in many an audience where I've stood or not stood for the Pledge of Allegiance. A few times I've had people in the audience confront me, but never, never has an executive official been so outrageous as to say that such behavior is unpatriotic or shameful. It's the most patriotic behavior of all. If there weren't an option to sit down during the Pledge of Allegiance, it would be meaningless to stand up. This is one of the only countries that requires such behavior. By God, what an outrage. Now, next door, a few blocks away, we have another outrage. The ICE. What is ICE becoming? It's becoming more evidence of our slope towards fascism. ICE is right now, under this current regime, very close to approaching the verge of a new American Gestapo. If you don't realize that, just read carefully what's being said out of Washington, D.C. I was in a meeting in Newburgh, New York, a city council meeting, where the idea of making Newburgh a sanctuary city was going to be discussed. It was an overflow crowd. 53% of Newburgh is immigrants. These people were terrified about what's going on. We don't need their stinking money. If you're worried about the $8 million, that barely pays for the furniture in the county building, from what I heard. And the other argument that I might hear from you that's going on, if we don't do it, someone else will. Well, my God, read the banality of evil. Study history. This is the slope that is exactly it. If we don't do it, hey, we want Auschwitz built in our town, because if we don't, someone else will, and we could use the money here. Get rid of those, get rid of ICE, set an example. Just like sitting down for the Pledge of Allegiance is a symbolic act that calls attention to an evil, your saying, we don't want anything to do with ICE, will be setting an example that might even get some national attention to say, people are starting to catch on to what's going on here and aren't going to take this crap anymore.
Okay, James Stack, regarding Orange County in general, I guess. Mr. Stack, you want us to bring the microphone up to you?
No, I'll get there. I'm not for like an American.
Okay, I know you can make it, but I'm just...
Don't ever break your ankle.
WB, Warren Buffett.
Nice to see you.
Yes, sir. Well, you don't realize when these landlords pay $70,000, $80,000, $100,000 a year property tax. That's like Mr. Berkman knows. He has 5,600 apartments. They pay, he's got a lot of place, more godless. And all these taxes, how can you all want this economic. Well, you throw all this money away, all the time here, you sit here, right around the back of you, you got Solar City, 1 megawatt. It's been completed. When are you going to use it? This year, or we got a couple more years, it's 2020. That Solar City, they completed it for you. When are you going to, I'd like to have an answer to the attorney there, she should know. When are you going to tap onto it? So all this stuff you have to pay on tomorrow, Con Ed. I got to prove the I'm time pressure. I live in a house built in 1821. That's beside you. And my 8 acres, I've got to prove they're putting in 10 megawatts. True, I'm going to sell it to Orange Regional and all the big hospital. That's beside you. But I'm just saying, you all look at me, but when are you going to do it? Are you going to... When we're dead, or when... See, that's, you can pass all these bills and all this stuff. That's God, I said, more there. Bonds. Well, that's going to dry up someday. I'm just saying, that's number one, the solar. And number two, if possible, we're still in hard economic times, except the stock market. But if would you entertain putting a freeze on all county employee hiring for a year or two. But a freeze. I had nothing to do with Republican Democrat. This is a business person. You taxes go up every year. Look at the school tax. Oh, that's it's only high schools. It's not MIT or Harvard or South Bend, Notre Dame. I'm just saying, would you entertain? What's your name, the lawyer? What's your name?
Antoinette.
Antoinette who? It's mainly Antoinette.
Reed.
Reed?
We're not here to discuss that.
Well, Reed, is it? Well, can you do something with the freeze on all hiring for a year or two? County employees?
Antoinette can talk to you after the meeting and give you an opinion.
Yeah, right.
Her personal opinion.
Here's the state. Here you're
we'll let her stay past the hour.
Sheriff over here. the nice people. But why does the people, 2 years ago, you hired, well, I do my own deeds over here, record my own deeds or whatever. What do you have to hire another company, Atlas? For what? I'm more of a burden on the taxpayer. More of a burden. Why do you have to hire a company like that or any company like that? What's the matter with your sheriff? Why can't they do it? Let's, I have 3 minutes to talk?
Yeah, we'll give you another 30 second grace period.
Okay, you're a sport.
Yeah. That's probably the best compliment I've had today. Thank you, Jim.
What the?
And they're not done with me yet, either.
No, here's somebody. So, here's your...
Matt's got a whole page over here, I think. Sorry, I'll give you another 15 seconds.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
God bless America. I'm rubbing his golden hair. That's a good. Well, no, I just, if you... You got that one... What is it, how much that cost you? Well, it's $2 million per megawatt. What did it cost you, over $2 million? A solar city? A solar... They're about $34 a share of them the other day. Solar city. How much that cost the county?
Not sure, but maybe call Wayne Booth. You know, next
week. Who the hell ever was?
I'll give you the number.
I heard of John Brooks Booth. John Brooks Booth. I heard of him. Can you entertain these freeze on hiring to save money? That's simple thing. And it's Solar City over here. And why do you have to hire more and more? Being more of a burden. I don't want to do that, Patricia. Have a good night.
Thank you, Jim. Okay, Matt, say a few words.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's been a long session. When we have these long agendas, I'm appreciative of you being at the helm. You know, you get us right through it quite fast, along with the majority leader by grouping together. So I'll be brief. I want to start by saying that, I'm big into, when I get confused, and that's often, I kind of try to find the guiding principle. And I'm really proud of the Democratic Caucus because we have discussions and we often look for a consensus on issues, because that's kind of a partisan thing that either party might do, is try to find, a consensus on an issue. Especially when it comes to bonded issues. If we can all agree, that's somewhere we can flex our muscles and show that we still have some power, that we could defeat a bonded issue. That seldom happens, and I'll tell you why it doesn't happen. Because in our caucus, everybody owns their own vote. And they refuse to take a position simply to be a partisan. And I think that's the guiding issue, the guiding principle that we try to go by. I was listening to Antoinette Reed talk about the legislative manual. I don't think I'm out of order. I don't think she's suggesting that I'm out of order by asking these questions and making these claims and saying what I'm saying. But government is at its best when the two parties work together, and that's basically what I'm trying to do. I don't think my efforts to share power are partisan in any way. And certainly, I think that, when you suggest that any legislator is asking too many questions, and that's not to say there aren't stupid questions asked by legislators at times, or questions that may not be appropriate. But, that's how we get answers. And I think the net result is that we get, we do more good than bad by asking the questions that we ask. The only other thing I would say is that, when Roxanne was chairman of the legislature, I believe that there was sharing of power. There was four Democratic chairs, and there was four Republican chairs. We're not asking for that. We're just asking for something. That's what we've been asking for.
We've had that discussion about the leadership meeting. We haven't had a leadership meeting since August. The question on the tourism would have been a lot easier for me to process if we had had a meeting, a leadership meeting on that. And finally, I just want to say that I don't understand when the chairman asks me to submit a name for a committee and he rejects that name without explanation. You know, our caucus is united in that submission. They all agree that that was the proper person to place on that committee. Now I got to go back to my caucus and say that name was rejected. I don't understand that. I'm just looking for answers. I'm looking, you know, in the end, I'm just looking to do my job the right way.
I understand the motion to adjourn. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.